go ahead and get ready. This part of the show, we're going to sound smarter than we do on the other parts of the show.
First of all, that's not hard to do. Like, that's a low bar.
Well, James Okonkwo is here.
Yeah.
And anytime he talks, we all sound collectively smarter.
Yeah.
James, thanks for being here, making us sound smarter. Go ahead, do it.
How you doing? This is James Okonkwo.
See?
It's something about the accent. It just, like, just raises the IQ in the room, I guess.
Yeah, that's all it takes.
Is it weird to you that we all think that you sound so smart? And do we sound smart?
Yeah, I've been all around America for a while. This is like my fourth year in America. Everywhere I go, people just say, I just want to hear you talk. And then I don't know what to say. It's like, I ask you, what am I supposed to say? I'm just like, just say anything. I'm like, okay. Then I'm rambling for 5 minutes. And it is what it is. I'm getting used to it. But yeah.
Okay, so... And I don't know this. Like, I'm not asking and, like, secretly know the answer and want it. But, like, how did you eventually make your way to the States? Obviously, James is originally from the United Kingdom, from England. How did you make your way here originally?
That's a great question. That's a story in itself.
That's right. We got all day. We got nowhere to go.
So, basically, it started in the UK. We call it secondary school. America, we call it high school. I was in, I think it was my fourth year of competition, and my club team called Reading Rockets. I think it was the under 16s. And we basically had an undefeated season up to that point, and we were getting ready for the playoffs. And then COVID struck, and then basically our playoffs were canceled. So we were like projected to win the entire thing that year, but playoffs cut it out, so we couldn't do anything. So I was just at home. I made like a little highlight reel of all my games because some of the parents like record other games, so I just put it out on YouTube. I think it's still out there. And then I just made that, and then some high school coaches. My main high school coach Tracy Justin Dempsey. He saw that, and he reached out to me, and he offered me a scholarship to go to high school in America. It was my only one. It was either that or go to what we call the EABL in the UK, and I just opted in to go to high school. So I came in as a sophomore. I think I turned 16. I've been here for so long, I forgot. Honestly, I'm just losing the track of days. But yeah, I came in. I suffered an injury, but it wasn't anything serious. I just played through it. And then I just ended up redshirting and going to West Virginia. I still need to get that year back, but went to West Virginia. And then I was there for the last 2 years, and now I'm here. And I was doing the FIBA European Championship this summer with Great Britain, and then we lost to Macedonia in the quarterfinals, which was the host team. They were a pretty good team, but I think we could have won that one. But yeah, now I'm down in Chapel Hill. So
you made it sound very simple, but I have to think being 15 or 16 years old and deciding I'm going to move to a country that, as far as I know, you've never been to before.
Yeah.
To go to school, like, that must have been a pretty tough decision.
Yeah, it was. At the end of the day, I felt as if I had what it takes to get to where I am now, and obviously I had confidence in my ability to play the game, and my family believed in me, and my older brother did it before me. Both my brothers are tennis players. Oliver Okonkwo goes to University of Illinois, and my youngest brother, Alexander Okonkwo, goes to Tulsa. And they're both tennis players. They're both killing it right now. And my older brother did it before me, so he kind of paved the way for me to make it, like, make me understand that, oh, I can actually do this with this sport. Because up to the point before he went to America, I didn't really know the avenue I wanted to take to get to the NBA, and that's always been my aspiration. But, yeah, he just opened my eyes to that opportunity, and it's gone right so far. With Coach Davis and these amazing guys on this team right now, and it's been a dream so far.
What is West Virginia like? I've never been there.
It's really unique. Obviously, it's a beautiful state. If you like going on hikes and everything like that, it's like mountain watching and stuff like that.
Do you like going on hikes?
I personally no, not my cup of tea. I've been on a few, but it's hard to hike when you're 6'9", 240.
Yeah, so, I can understand that. Yeah. Tough on the feet.
Tough on the feet, definitely. And I don't want to like roll my ankle and then go back to practice and ask why am I injured. That'd be terrible. But yeah, it's a really unique state. And they showed me a lot of love for the 2 to 3 years I was there. And I'm very grateful for that experience. So,
Now, you mentioned your brothers are tennis players. I've heard that you might be a good tennis player.
Yeah, I played for 8 to 9 years before I started playing basketball. So I think I started playing basketball around, I want to say 14. That's too late. Around 12 to 13. So yeah, this is my 9th season of basketball, maybe 10th. So.
And before that, you played tennis?
Before that, I played tennis.
How good are you?
Now I haven't played in a while, but if I played someone who's like average, I don't think I'd lose. But that's just like my competitiveness, I guess. But
Are you like college tennis player good?
No. My serve is probably on par, but after the first shot, I'm basically screwed. So
why did you transition from tennis? Did you just get too big for tennis?
Yeah, there was I was getting, my athleticism was kicking in, and my frame was matching up with my athleticism. I was getting a little bit taller, and I think I just grew out of love for the sport, and I started playing basketball, and I started having a lot of fun with it.
Yeah.
And I was playing basketball during my lunch breaks every day. I had like 2 lunch breaks for like 30 minutes. I'd just go and shoot, come in after school, go shoot for like an hour, then go to practice. So that was just like my daily life when I was at high school. And I got strong enough and quick enough and skilled enough to come over to America, and I am where I am now.
Did you ever go to Wimbledon?
Wimbledon, I did. I went with my mother one time.
Nice.
That was a completely different world. I forgot who we played though. Or who we watched when we went down there. But I think we made it to court one. That was a pretty cool experience.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I assume the basketball skill level in the United States is higher than in Great Britain.
Yeah.
In general,
yeah. I think it's just, you just have more people in America.
Right,
it's
right.
More competition, I guess. Yeah.
So how did you know when you knew that you were, like, I'm good for Great Britain, you knew that. How did you know you'd be good for America?
Honestly, it was just the pathway I knew I had to take to get into college, and then from college to get to the NBA, and it was obviously the most popular choice. Me, I'm a competitive fiend, so I see all of these amazing like basketball players in America, and I just jumped at the opportunity to get better, and because of that, I've got stronger every year, got faster every year, got a better defender, better at rim protecting. I just became better each year just from competing against the best guys I could. And you get that automatically when you play in the Big 12 like I did last year. And it's just one of those things. I just love competing, I guess. And I think I have a chance to do that here. So
why was Carolina, because that it was like late in the game that you ended up making the move to Chapel Hill. Why was Carolina the right choice for you?
I was really on board with what Coach HD was saying, Coach Davis. He said I had almost opportunity to come down here and play, back up on Mondo, give that motor and athleticism off the bench that to this point he thinks he was missing. And my appetite for defense and rim protecting and running the floor, he just feels as if that would be a really useful addition to the team, and that's kind of what I specialize in. And I'm working on my offensive game too, working on my perimeter shooting and stuff like that. So just trying to get as good as I can get to help the team win and get to the NBA after everything's done in college.
Was it hard? I mean, so obviously you were playing, as you said, in the Big 12. This is very good basketball there. Mm-hmm. So, but was it tough to come to Carolina maybe a little later than everybody else and kind of get acclimated to what was happening here?
Not really. It was, Coach HD's done a really good job with communicating with all the players, especially me. Coming in late, Coach May's done a good job with getting me down on par with the rest of the guys, getting used to, like, we have different coverages. Coach Sully's been doing a good job with helping me with those, and it's just watching a little bit extra film.
Sure.
Doing a little bit extra work outside of the court, and I'm not afraid of doing work. So, yeah, it's a little bit not ideal, but these guys have made sure that I am where I am, so can't complain.
How physical is a West Virginia practice under Bob Huggins? Like, in my mind, just people beating on each other. What's it actually like?
It's like that. Yeah, it's like, I'd be lying if I say it wasn't. Coach Huggs loves his treadmills. He loves when you get opposite. He loves offensive rebounds, just playing that blue-collar type basketball, playing physical. And I guess that's where my appetite from just physicality and competition came from. he did a good job of instilling that from me, because I came to college when I was like 17. So I just believed in my coach and went from there.
Okay, did you have to learn the words to "Take Me Home, Country Roads"?
Yeah. It was after every win, so when you're there as long as I was, it's just second nature at this point.
Right. It just clicks for you. You just know.
And it was weird because I'd hear it in places where I shouldn't be hearing it. When I went back home the following season after my freshman year, people were sending me TikToks, people I don't know, of Country Roads, of people singing them in like Ireland and Scotland. I was like, fair enough, I didn't know this was a worldwide thing. But yeah, it was quite funny. It was a good experience. So,
okay, speaking of being worldwide,
yeah,
this podcast has listeners all over the world.
Yeah, it does.
Including Maidenhead, England.
Oh, really?
We got an email from Abram and Kerry Graham about a month ago when they realized you were on the roster. And they said, when you have James come in, you have to ask him these three questions.
Okay.
Question number one. Have you ever been to see the guinea pigs on Ray Mill Island?
The guinea pigs on Ray Mill Island? I can't say that I have. I don't think I have.
Okay.
No.
James is a no on the guinea pigs.
No on the
number two. Did you support the local football club, the Magpies?
No, I didn't. No, we're my family are a Chelsea team. We're a Chelsea soccer team.
Who are the Magpies?
Maidenhead Magpies.
That seems slightly lower level than Chelsea.
James doesn't seem impressed.
I didn't have a choice. I was a kid. My dad said, "You're supporting Chelsea." I was like, "Okay, cool." That's why I was like, "Fine." I haven't watched a lot of soccer recently, though, since I came to America, but.
But men's soccer in the Elite Eight this weekend. You can watch men's soccer on Saturday.
That's a very good point. I think Chelsea came down here.
Yeah, they did. Yeah.
They played
Rex,
and they were there like literally like a week before my visit. And I was like, that would have been a great visit, but
that would have sealed it for sure.
Yeah, Chelsea plays here. Yeah. I'm in. Yeah.
They're here all the time. This is not unusual at all. Okay, question three. He's been a no on one and two. What was your favorite local pub in Maidenhead?
I don't drink. So I can't answer that.
What's the best hangout spot in Maidenhead? Like, if we come see you in Maidenhead, you're going to be like, I'm going to take you here.
Where am I going to be? That's a great question. Probably there's a park called Kidwell's Park. Now there are a lot of basketball players out during the summer. So when I was growing up, or when I was in the high school, there weren't a lot of like people who would like go out and just play street basketball like that, but... I'd just be working out by myself. But now, every time I go back in the summer, there's like 30, 40 people just there playing basketball, and it's really good to see. And whenever I go back, I just get to link up with all my old guys again, play fives on the park, on the half court, and play 3-on-3, and it's just... That's probably where I spend most of my time out during summer. If not, I'm either in the weight room or just like getting recovery, making sure my body's where it needs to be, but... Yeah, I just like playing basketball, so I'm just out on the court all day.
What part of England will never leave James Okonkwo? And what part of America did you say, you know what, that I'm never going to be down with that, but now you're totally into it now that you've been here?
What part am I never going to forget about England?
Like, it'll just never leave you. It's always going to be a part of your story.
Probably everything I did at... at Reading Rockets, because that was, especially in my last two seasons, that was we really came in together as a group, and I'm still keep in touch with all of my old guys. But that last year in Reading, when I was like 15, 16, that was probably one of the highest points of my life. Just getting out there, being able to just run up and down, play basketball with my guys for us, like every week.
Yeah.
And we'd have like three or four practices a week. It was a high point in my life.
Now there's got to be something about America where you're like, that seems, when you were living, you're like, that seems really stupid.
When I first came, something that seemed stupid. That's a difficult question.
There's got to be something where you're like, man.
Because there are some things, but I don't want to get in trouble for saying it. Like, I don't want to get in trouble for saying it. There's only one of me. There's a whole lot of Americans in Chapel Hill.
Fair enough. That's fair enough.
Yeah,
there's some things that you'd rather keep to yourself.
Let me... tailgates.
Oh!
Tailgates.
Okay.
Tailgates. West Virginia tailgates, to be specific.
No, I bet they get a little intense.
Yeah, because I don't drink, so I'm sober in the middle of a crowd of a bunch of fans that like they're happy to be there, but I just feel out of place, I guess. But yeah,
there you go.
The tailgates.
No tailgates for a big soccer match, Adam.
Yeah.
Unless Chelsea's in town.
Yeah, that's right.
Then
yeah.
Things could be different. Okay, you spent a lot of time practicing against Armando Bacot. Mm. A lot of time people don't see, the hours and hours and hours down there under the basket.
Mm-hmm.
What do we not see about him because we don't practice against him that you know and you understand he's so good because of this that you see every day?
He just does the simple things very efficiently. Like his seals, like whenever there's a pick and roll on the weak side, he's on the weak side block. He seals incredibly strong, like he should. He has pretty good touch around the rim. His positioning on his rebounding is almost perfect. Like that's probably what makes it hard to rebound against him. Not that he's not overly athletic when he goes to rebound the ball, so to say, but his positioning is he's just in the right place, and it's hard to get around that. He's pretty good with his hands, pretty good with his feet, and it's just a culmination of all these things that make him a really good basketball player. So,
we have had some soccer players from England in mm-hmm. here before,
mm.
and they have tried to educate us about whether we should refer to them as English or British. Do you have a preference when Jones is talking about you, when you're out there grabbing the rebound, should he say the English Tar Heel or the British Tar Heel? Which do you prefer?
I'll take British. I think most people that they ask me where I'm from, I just say Britain because there's the United Kingdom and then there's Great Britain and then there's England. And I'm not going to sit here for 20 minutes to explain the difference.
Right.
Because then we'll all be bored. But yeah, I'll go with British. It's just easier to remember.
On it. Just the third Tar Heel ever from England. Like that. You seem to play with an edge. That is what I have come to from watching you in practice, you just seem to have a little hard edge to you. Do you think that's accurate?
Yeah, as I said, I love competing. I just love giving everything I have. And if I don't, then I'm just gonna feel terrible afterwards. And if I come out of practice not sweating buckets and tired, I feel as if I wasted a day. So,
do you make other people mad on the court?
I can neither confirm nor deny that. I think so. I think it's good for the team, though. I think if you have that one person who's going after it every possession, then it inspires the rest of the team to go after it with the same intensity, and that's how we win. So,
yeah.
You know.
That's what I have to do for Jones.
That's right. Every podcast. Adam's got to bring a little extra juice to the studio.
Yeah.
You said you're a competitive fiend.
Mm-hmm.
Has your competitiveness ever gotten you in trouble?
I think I got a technical in Europe this past tournament because I was talking to this one dude. We both had like 20 points. He scored a bucket on me. It was the luckiest bucket ever. And he was chirping a little bit down the other side of the floor. And I was smiling, talking junk back. And we both got double-teed. So probably that. That was the most recent the most recent instance. But not really during the game or practice because I'm just focused on going 100% every possession I can. I don't really have time for it. But.
What about away from the court? Are you still a competitive fiend away from the court?
Yeah, I'd say I am. It's hard to turn it off sometimes.
Well, sometimes normal people don't like that. Like, they can't So has it ever gotten you in trouble there?
I tried. Nah, not yet. I'm going to hopefully say not yet because I know it will eventually. But it is what it is.
I'm not sure I believe that.
I don't think I do either.
James has all these stories and he's like, you know what, guys? I'm not sure this is the time or the place for me to throw these out here just yet.
You got some more years with us, James. You're either going to tell us later or you're going to tell us now.
We'll get you later. You seem like a very serious person to me. Are you very serious? Like, would you classify yourself that way?
Yeah, I'd say I'm about my business. I'd say I'm a serious dude, but if I'm just with my guys and we're not playing basketball, we're just in the locker room chilling, I can chill out a little bit.
Okay. Who are some of your guys? Like, who here? I know you got guys all over the place.
Yeah.
But who are some of the guys who you've gotten close with here so far?
Definitely Jay Witt and Harrison. They're two of the funniest people on the team. Jay Witt just makes me laugh all the time. Harrison just says the most outlandish and stupid things and just make me laugh. Then RJ is really funny too. Mondo's really funny as well. And they're just, this is probably like this team is really close together, and you can tell. And then we'd have a lot of laughs and chemistry, and it's really cool.
Everybody who comes in here talks about Harrison talking all the time.
Yeah.
Harrison talks really fast.
Yeah, he does. He talks like 100 miles an hour.
Yeah, he does.
Was it?
Or 100 kilometers an hour.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Was it hard to, like, it was hard for me to get my ears acclimated to his pace of speaking. Was that difficult?
Does he talk that fast all the time, or is it just in
interviews? Not all the time.
Okay, it's just like interviews.
Yeah, just around Boston, I guess. I guess he's just thinking about all this stuff, I guess. I'm not sure.
Do you think he thinks about the trash he's going to talk, or does it just come naturally?
Is it premeditated?
Right, yeah.
some of the things I'll be thinking, there's no way he just came up with that on the spot. That has to be. But yeah, he's pretty good at what he does. He's pretty good at that.
Give us an example.
Ah, I don't think I can do that without getting in trouble. I don't think I can do that.
The off the air part of this podcast is incredible.
You start drawing up plays. What do you like to do away from basketball?
I'm on the game a lot with my brothers and stuff like that. I have a dog I take care of.
Whoa, what kind of dog is it?
She's a pit bull mutt, so she's mixed with a lot of different things, but. She turned one like 3 days ago.
How big is she?
She's not that big. She's about, if I stood up, her head would probably be just on my hip. So she's pretty long, but
That's pretty big.
She's skinny though. She's not like advertly like chunky and sit, but she's like tall. She's a female dog as well.
I got you.
Do you feel like you're a good like dog parent?
Yeah. She does what I tell her to do, and that stops her from getting hit by cars. So I think I'm pretty good at
that's
my job.
That's half the battle.
Keeping
honestly.
That alive is half the battle. So, like, my boy, I'm trying to tell my cousin down.
No, that's all right. Like, that's twice today. Then.
That's right.
It's no problem.
So you're a better dog parent than Mondo. Because Mondo's dog doesn't do what he tells it to do. I don't even think it's house trained.
Oh, I can't.
You know it's true.
You're trying to get me in trouble.
No, I'm
you're
the one who said it.
You're trying to get me in trouble. I believe in my abilities to take care of my dog, and I'm sure Mondo is the same.
That's half of parenting, is believing you know what you're doing.
Yes, okay, I'm going to ask you a very this is a serious question, because Adam's got a big problem with cursing all the time.
I'll go you.
So, like, how are you able to turn it off when you're not supposed to be cursing? Like, right now. Like, because Adam's cursing. I have to bleep Adam all the time.
Daily.
That's a great question. I think in practice now, obviously, Coach Davis doesn't support that type of language, and I try to. It's new to me, I guess.
You mean Bob Huggins was okay with that type of language?
Again, I can't confirm or deny. But I just try and tone it down out of respect for my coach. It's the way he wants the team to be. So he's the head coach, that's his job. So I'll just go by it. But obviously, there are times like that where I slip and I'm not fully locked in. But. But I apologize and I get back to it. So,
okay, that brings up two important questions. Number one, how did you handle it the first time you heard Coach Davis tell someone to, for example, get the fart out?
I had to hide my face. I had to look at the ground because I wasn't expecting it. I didn't know. And then he said I was looking around. I was confused. Because I'm not used to that. But, yeah, it's
that's got to be tough. Yeah. Not to, like, break, like, not to have...
Now, like, obviously now I understand his values and I respect them, obviously, but the first time it happened, I wasn't expecting it. And that was my first practice. I, like, smoked a layup and I cursed, like, at the top of my lungs. And everybody stopped. I was like, oh, my bad. I was like, my fault. I didn't know. My bad.
Well, especially coming from Bob Huggins.
Yeah.
I guess he probably didn't say get the fart out.
Not exactly like that. But, yeah.
Okay, now my second question is, I need you to explain something to me. The next time I go to England, how bad...
Could be next week.
Yeah, it could be any time. No. I don't know. How bad is it really to say bloody? Like,
it's
if you say something
bad.
Is bloody bad, like, what...
It's, okay.
Compare that to something I would understand.
I use it now to, like, substitute for my curse words.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Because we don't know how bad it is.
Yeah, it's not like a scale. It's just, like, a substitute for saying... like a swear word or something like that, but
so it can mean it's got like a range. It can mean a lot of different things.
It can like I can just be saying like casual, or I can be like absolute, like just like it just like depends on the way you say it, I guess.
If a 10-year-old said it in school,
you'd be fine.
It's fine.
Yeah, you'd be fine.
Okay,
I'm not condoning anything. in my eyes, you'd be fine.
I always thought it was worse than that.
Nah. If I said, like, bloody hell. Like, I'd only say if I was, like, if I, like, messed up a play and I'm...
That's what you should say if you miss a layup.
Bloody hell.
Bloody hell.
What about... Maybe I'll take this part out. What about... Where are we on
yeah,
the...
Yeah, can't say that one. Can't say that one. Say that one. That one's a little bit more R-rated. That one's a little bit more R-rated. I don't tell the kids to say that one. and I'm not gonna
look, I'm just trying to get my bearings on what I can and can't say.
Honestly, yeah. It's fine. It's not like a swear word, but it's just one of those things that if you say in the wrong context, you're gonna get in trouble.
I can understand that. Yeah, I understand that.
See, that's why you have to ask.
Yeah, that's why we had James come on here.
That's right.
Clearly.
By the way, I was totally flummoxed when I saw your last name, but now I've got it perfectly like on my little sheet. So I'm 100% in it now.
I got you.
Okonkwo. Yes. I love it. Perfect. It's just cool to say.
Yeah.
Okay. Take us through what's important here. You guys got now we are speaking to James before the Tar Heels play Tennessee. You will hear this after the Tar Heels play Tennessee. But this is a difficult stretch coming up, these next couple of games. What in your mind is important here over the next 3-4 weeks or so for you guys to achieve what you want to achieve?
Well, especially this week, I think it's important for the team to be locked in. Coach has done a good job of highlighting everything that we need to do to stay on top of this stretch of games. Tennessee, they're going to come in. Obviously, they lost their last two games. They're going to come in with some fire. And we need to lock in as a unit to make sure that everybody's where they need to be so that I know where I need to be. So we can execute, get that win, and move on. I think they're 7th or 10th in the AP.
10th, yeah.
Yeah, they're a good basketball team, and they're not going to come here just to roll over and lose. And we know that, but we got to have a lot of energy off the bench. We got to execute all of our defenses, and we've got to hit the glass, got to defend, and we'll be okay.
Oh, last thing. I wanted to ask you this earlier. This really will be the last question. Mm-hmm. What makes a good shot blocker? Because, I mean, from what I have seen so far, you are an excellent shot blocker. What makes a good shot blocker?
It depends on the type of the archetype of the player. Obviously, if you have a player like Jay Wash, he's a little bit taller, wiry, longer wingspan, then obviously it's just timing. For me, I try and – mine's probably timing as well, but I got to obviously use a little bit more athleticism to get up there. I say just timing and ability to read the defense, look at their eyes. Normally, if they're looking at the rim, they're probably going to shoot the ball. and at the same time, understanding if he's going for a hezzy is probably not the best time to jump. I learned that the hard way. and yeah, just staying locked in the moment and just trying to guess where it's going to be at, trying to anticipate. And yeah, just you just got to be smart and time it properly.